Good morning, everyone. I'd like to greet you in Jesus' name as well. It's good to be gathered together in the name of our Lord. He is our source of confidence. He is the hope. He is the anchor of our souls. And it's in Him that we rejoice and find our strength. We're going to be continuing in our series in 1 Corinthians. We're in chapter 2, beginning at verse 6. To the end of the chapter, that's the portion that I'll be covering this morning. I'd like to read that portion of Scripture this morning first, before we launch in. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, beginning at verse 6. Howbeit, we speak wisdom among them which, or that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor of the princes of this world that come to naught. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. But God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit, for the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. For what man knoweth the things of man, save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man, but the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things which are freely given unto us of God. Which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. But he that is spiritual judgeth all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. For who hath known the mind of the Lord, that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ so far. Now we've been dealing with wisdom pretty much since we've started 1 Corinthians, talking about the wisdom of the world, talking about the wisdom within the church, or really the way that it's been portrayed, probably a lack thereof in the church. Really, in Corinth here, Corinth has been portrayed so far as maybe not the sharpest knife in the drawer, not the brightest of the bunch, maybe a little more lackluster. And we get this impression from some of the scriptures that we've gone over. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 26, you may recall, for ye see your calling, brethren, reference directly to the church, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. Okay, well, that doesn't sound too promising at this point. You know, Paul says in chapter 2, he begins the chapter this way, and this was what was shared last week, and I, brethren, when I came to you, came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom. And then he continues in verse 3, and I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of men's wisdom. So here we have what we get in the church. And yet crowds come together and you come and you listen to the preaching of the word when there's such lack of wisdom in it, when there's so little to be gleaned, when there's nothing mighty or noble about it, when it's mocked by the world at large. Well, if to this point in Corinth the church has been viewed as less than, this morning the page turns. And there is a wisdom that we're going to highlight that is in the church, that is primarily in the church, as revealed by the Holy Spirit of God. But it is a wisdom that is hidden from the world. That's why I've titled the message this morning, Hidden Wisdom. Hidden Wisdom. So for this, I need a victim, a volunteer is what I was hoping for. And I've already kind of tapped Greg on the shoulder. I'd like to ask you to come join me up here, Greg. You're such a willing volunteer. Now, I'm going to demonstrate for you this morning some hidden wisdom. And you can use this guy here. And then join me at this piece of paper, if you will. There's a marker for you. If you want to stand on the one side, I'll stand in there. Just watch the step there. All right, hidden wisdom. This is the kind of hidden wisdom you get when you attend Beacon Bible Chapel. No, this might only be for elders, all right? For those who preach. I'm going to do a bit of math. How's your math? Math pretty good?
Yeah.
Not, okay, all right, good, because we need really smart people for this.
Okay.
I'm going to give you a number. Say 75,000, 432. And we'll stick that right back on. See? That's why I needed the help. Now, I want you to add your own numbers here, and this is going to be an addition problem.
Okay.
Five digits, five numbers you put underneath my number, any numbers you choose, except they have to be between 0 and 9, the individual numbers. Yeah, that's really not a problem. So, five digits, any number you want, put it underneath this number here for this addition problem.
Okay.
You choose the numbers. Go ahead and put them on.
And it literally doesn't matter.
It does not matter as long as they're between 0 and 9.
I love that.
Three, eight, okay. Two, oh, are you sure the two? Oh, that's fine. No problem.
I'm an overthinker. You're okay. Really stressing me out.
3, 8, 2, 1, 1. Okay, very good. Thank you. Now, I'm going to choose my own numbers to add as well. And we're going to have a total of 5 numbers here. So I'm going to say, you've used 3 here, so I'm going to go with a 6. 1, 7, and... 61,788. Now, we're going to have you add another number, and then I'm going to add another number, but I'm going to give you the answer first. How do you like that? It's pretty good. This is where hidden wisdom comes in, folks.
Okay.
So the answer is going to be 275,400 and... Oh, wait. Before I finish the last digit, I need you to do something here. So, face the crowd here, hold up your left hand, and do this.
It's not working.
Okay. All right.
We need another volunteer to help.
So here's, you have an opportunity to redeem yourself. Try this. Okay,
yeah,
all right, okay.
Idea, yeah.
Now clearly, as a result of this, the last number is 0. Sorry, that wasn't very high. Okay. Now, turning back to...
I can turn around?
Yeah, you can turn back to the board here. 275,430. Now, don't do any quick math in your mind. Just do any additional 5 random numbers here.
Because I have no idea what your numbers
are. Another row of 5 random numbers.
Okay.
Just, and when you write the number down, just say it out loud into the mic so that everybody can hear.
Like each digit?
Each digit, yep.
Okay. Okay. 5, 7, 9, 5, 8.
Okay, thank you. You sure you want? Well, too late now. That's
yes.
What you want. Okay, so I'm going to add the last number here. We'll give it a 42,041. Now, if you would be so kind as to do the math, add them up and see what your total is, see if the answers match. And you speak right into the mic, do your adding it, remember to carry, and if you need your fingers, I can offer my toes, whatever we need.
Okay, so we got 8, 8, 16, 17, 18, 20. So we got 2, 0, 5, 6. 10,
13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 23. You're counting. Some of you have got your calculators out.
Used to using my my calculator.
I know I'm putting pressure on you.
I know.
Some people think I call volunteers up here just to embarrass them, and they're right. I mean they would be wrong, of course.
23. Yeah, that works. So.
That works? Really?
So far.
So far.
I got 23, 2, 3, 4, 6. Okay, halfway-ish there.
I don't know why this is so hard. I already gave you the answer.
I know, right? I'm checking your work.
All right, good.
It totally does work out.
How in the world did this work? Well, thanks for confirming my answer. Appreciate that. That's all
You're welcome.
That I need for now. Thanks
really?
Very much. Appreciate
okay.
that. You're brilliant. That was excellent. Now, we didn't discuss anything here in advance. And yet, here you go. How is it possible that I could have in any way, shape, or form known and predicted the number that was given? And yet here we have it. Hidden wisdom, folks. No, really, this is just math. This is just math. There's a nice little way to figure that out, and I'll let you think about it. If Christians aren't wise, does that then make them simple? If Christians are not mighty, does that then make them weak? If they are not noble, does that cause them to become outcasts? What makes an individual wise? Well, the father of Western philosophy was said to be Socrates. Now, he was a philosopher, the first philosopher, if you will, from Athens. Remember, that was a neighboring city to Corinth during this time. And he was actually brought before the courts and killed because he was smart and really annoyed his neighbors. But he had said that the only true wisdom is knowing that you know nothing. Now, there is some wisdom to this, right? We would say, yeah, okay, some truth to that, and that's good. But there is a level of wisdom that Socrates and all of his contemporaries can't offer us. And that is a wisdom that the church receives from a different place, a higher plane altogether. And I would suggest to you that the scripture lays it very plain for us and makes it very clear what the source of that wisdom is. And you have numerous references you could refer to, but we're going to look at Proverbs 9. Verse 10, which states this: the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the holy is understanding. This is what we're going to come to see this morning in the passage that we're covering. In chapter 2 of 1 Corinthians, beginning at verse 6, we read the following, again, saying that Paul came and said, you know, I didn't come to you with worldly wisdom, with eloquence of speech, with all of these things that the world looks to, especially in Corinth, seeking wisdom. The Greeks were all about wisdom, earthly wisdom. He says, howbeit, we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, among them that are mature. He's making reference of the people in the church, the mature Christians. And to the mature Christians, that which Paul spoke was wisdom. Yet not the wisdom of this world, he says, nor of the princes of this world. This wisdom for mature believers that Paul was preaching in the church, the world would have rejected it outright. The wise of the world, the princes, the noble, those of understanding, Socrates himself, probably would have rejected it outright and said, foolishness, foolishness, makes no sense. And these princes of the world, they have come to nothing. Christians do not lack wisdom, because Paul was preaching it here in the church to the Christians. But what they do have is a different kind of wisdom, a different type of wisdom. This is the kind that's usually dismissed by the wise of the world as foolish. Verse 7, but we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery. This is the kind of wisdom that we possess within the church. The mature believer possesses the wisdom that comes from God. The wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom. Now, it's a hidden wisdom because it's not very easy to find. Anyone from the outside looking in doesn't recognize it. In fact, even Christians, young, immature Christians, will often overlook the wisdom. They will not grasp it. They do not see it. They will not recognize it. It's over their heads. The scripture says as much, right? We begin as babes in the milk of the word, but we need to, through learning and understanding of the scriptures, get to the place where we can start consuming strong meat. We move on from those simple foundational truths into the deep things of God. This is hidden wisdom, which God ordained before the world unto our glory. You know what this hidden wisdom is? This hidden wisdom is the gospel. The gospel of Jesus Christ. This was a secret from all the world until the time of Christ. The gospel. How we might be saved and brought back into right relationship with our Creator. The gospel. That gospel which was put in place before the foundation of the world. We find this in Ephesians chapter 1, right? That Jesus, before the foundation of the world, had been put in place for the salvation of mankind, before the foundation of the world. And to what end? It says, unto our glory. For the purpose that we might recognize the gospel, that we might receive Jesus Christ as Lord, and ultimately be glorified. It was for our glory. Not so that we might receive glory and might think, like the wise of the world, thus am I, thus it is with me. The glory is God's glory shared with us so that we might ultimately be glorified in his presence for eternity, that we might share in his glory. This was the purpose. Which, verse 8, speaking of this glory, none of the princes of this world knew. The wisest among us, the wisest in the world, didn't grasp it, didn't recognize it, didn't see it for what it was. For had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Had they recognized who Jesus was and what his purpose and intent was, Jesus wouldn't have gone to the cross. But they didn't recognize it. Imagine that. The wisest of the world missed the forest for the trees. Couldn't see or recognize the Lord himself, the Lord of their salvation. The one who came to redeem them, they destroyed. The one who came to save them, they led to a cross. Remarkable. This is what the wisdom of the world will get you. This is what it produces. But as it is written, this is an interesting passage. Verse 9 of 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Often quoted though, talking about, this is for fluttery-eyed Christians thinking about heaven and what heaven might be like. This is the passage that's often quoted. And it'll sound familiar to you right away. Eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. And that's awesome. This is wonderful. We love that passage. It's great. And certainly we can get fluttery-eyed and think about what the glories of heaven are going to be like. Eye hasn't seen, ear hasn't heard, it hasn't even entered into your heart. What amazing things God has prepared for those who love him. It's a great thought. It's an exciting thought. And Christians, often they'll sit around in the congregations and be like, oh, yes, it's going to be glorious. It's going to be wonderful. And indeed it will be. But look at the very next verse. Verse 10. But God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit. You were not a congregation that's sitting here thinking, oh, wouldn't it be nice to know all those things we don't know? Wouldn't it be nice to see all those things our eyes have not seen and our ears have not heard that God is preparing that we just have no idea about? No, we're told that God has revealed them to us. And how has he revealed them to us? By his Spirit. By his Spirit. For the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. Now, friends, who has known the mind of God and has been able to teach or instruct him? We're going to get to that later. Well, none of us, right? No one has instructed God. No one has sat God down and said, all right, Lord, now listen here. This is how it works. That's not how it works. But when God chooses to reveal something of himself, it has to be a choice of his own. From the top down, he reveals something of himself to us. And he has chosen to do so by way of his Holy Spirit. By the Spirit. Even the very deep things of God. These are not things that are perceived with earthly wisdom. These are not things that can be perceived by the keenest, sharpest eye. By the most careful listening ear, eye hath not seen, ear hath not heard, but by his Spirit, says the Lord. This is how those ingraspable, those things that we can't quite fathom, that's how they can be fathomed, by the Spirit of God, revealed by God himself to his children. And all of this, think about how it relates to the gospel. The world was lost. The world knew it was lost. The world was awaiting some kind of a savior. And we know this is the case everywhere. It wasn't only Israel. It wasn't only the Jews that were waiting a coming Messiah. Do you remember when Paul went through Athens? Through that city of the wisest of the Greeks? The wisest nation on the planet at the time. Smart people. And what did Paul say? He walked through the city beholding their devotions, the things they devoted themselves to. And he was looking around at all the different idols, the statues, the different things they had erected, and they found one that was to the unknown God. To the unknown God. And Paul went on to say, well, this is the God that I'm making known to you today. This is the God I'm telling you about. You see, they knew they needed someone, something above and beyond themselves, something that transcended their very best wisdom. And this was the God that Paul was preaching to them. It was about the gospel. They knew they needed a savior, but they didn't know where to look. It was hidden from view because they were looking through the eyes of their own wisdom, and it didn't measure up. The wisest of the world will not recognize, cannot recognize God because God is only seen and recognized in, through, and by the Spirit of God, which comes from Him. Read in Ephesians 3, verses 4 to 6. Whereby when ye read, ye may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ. Well, this is the kind of thing we're talking about. What kind of knowledge is this secret mystery that's in Christ? Which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel. Well, there it is. This was the secret revealed. And who was it revealed to? Well, not the smartest in the highest castles in the ivory towers. Not the wise princes of the world. But it was revealed often to the least, the last, the lowest. To those who would give up on their own wisdom and fear the Lord. Continue in verse 11. For what man knoweth the things of man, save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man but the Spirit of God. Well, friends, nobody knows you better than you know you, right? But how well do you know you? Sometimes it's actually quite common that I confuse myself because I can't think of what I was thinking I thought when I thought it. I think. Jeremiah says that the heart of man is desperately wicked. Who can know it? You know yourself better than anybody else knows you. Your spouse knows you better than anybody else other than yourself, probably, when it comes to human beings. But if we're honest, how well do we even really know ourselves? I mean, Hollywood paints this picture of all of your life is about going to find yourself. Well, I'm right here. Where do I need to go to find myself? I'm right here. But the thing they're saying is that we're wondering, we're searching, we don't have all the answers, we don't know. And yet, who knows us better than we know ourselves? Well, Jeremiah says the heart of man is desperately wicked. Who can know it? We can't even know ourselves. However, we know that God, He knows. He knows us. He's the one who tries the reins of the heart, according to Jeremiah 17, verse 10. God is the one who tries the motives. God is the one who knows and understands the why you do what you do when you do it. So God is the one who knows. But if you don't know yourself, I mean, you know yourself better than anyone else, as limited as that is. Well, even so, the things of God knoweth no man but the Spirit of God. Now, God doesn't have the problems that we have. He doesn't have the identity crisis that we often deal with. God is pretty solid. He's in good shape. Not a concern there. So God reveals the things about himself by his Spirit. The Spirit that is within God is God and knows God and can describe God. And the Spirit of God, of course, compared to ours, is a little more extensive. It goes a little bit beyond the best that we can offer, right? Isaiah 55, 8 and 9. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. If you can't keep track of your own thoughts and what you're thinking when you think it, then think of what God's thinking. And God knows what he's thinking, why he's thinking it, how he's thinking it, and when, and to what end. And these thoughts of God, he is willing to grant to us an understanding of as well. Verse 12. Now we have received not the spirit of the world. Now the spirit of the world and the very spirit that Socrates was espousing was that, well, we have a lot of things to learn and we're just
just never going to learn at all. And this is true. You know, you've heard the phrase, the more I learn, the more I realize I don't know anything. The less I recognize that I know, with the more I know. So that is the spirit of the world. It's a good thing to be in a place where you recognize you haven't got it all together, that you don't know or understand everything. But we have received not that spirit. Not the spirit of the world that says, oh, I don't know it all, and how can I possibly ever know it all? I just don't know. That is not the spirit we have received. According to the scriptures, we have received, those who have put their trust in Christ, the spirit which is of God. Now, if we have received the spirit which is of God, that means that we have received the spirit that actually knows the mind and thoughts of God. Now, that's pretty incredible. God, whose thoughts are higher than our thoughts, whose ways are far beyond our ways, as far as the heavens are from the earth. World's wisdom. Now, why have we been given this knowledge, this special hidden wisdom? We have received the Spirit which is of God. Why? That we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. That's why. That we may know the things that are freely given to us of God. You know, many of you are well aware of this. You've experienced it yourselves, even as I have. You're growing up, there was always this idea that you could not say that you were saved because you would be proud. You could hope that you were saved. You wouldn't go around saying, oh, I'm a Christian. I'm born again. I'm going to live in eternity with God. Oh, that would be so proud. You'd never, never should you say that. 1 John 5:13, it says, these things are written unto you that you may know, that you may know that you are saved. And this is part of that knowledge that we receive, that we may know the things that are because our spirits aren't going to be able to grasp it. It's way over our heads as far as the heaven is from the earth. So we need the very Spirit of God in order to understand the things of God, the very things that he has freely given to us. Which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. See, this is really distracting. This is what the world's wisdom does. Put that where it belongs, back on the ground. We don't speak the world's wisdom because that's what it produces. It falls flat. It will not hold up when testing comes. But the spiritual truths are revealed by the Spirit for our spiritual benefit, for that which lasts into eternity. And we have to compare things that are spiritual with spiritual things. But the natural man, verse 14, receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God. No, this is pretty simple, right? It's pretty obvious. The natural man who has not yielded and surrendered his life to Jesus Christ, who has not been given the gift of the Holy Spirit, cannot receive, perceive, or understand these truths that come from the Spirit, that are sourced from the Spirit, from God's very heart and mind. The natural man cannot receive them, for they are foolishness unto him. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. Okay, I'd like to do a little exercise here. Close your eyes for me, would you? Close your eyes, and in your mind's eye, I want you to think about the sanctuary here. With your eyes closed, now I want you to think about to your right. To your right, we have a couple of large pictures that have been put up. There's the words written on them, and it was a great job by our decorator here. She did a wonderful job with that. Can anyone tell me, not looking, in your mind's eye, what was it that was written on those two frames. Can anyone say? Or what it's about? Vision statement, mission statement. This is somebody who came for the first time. That's great. Now, excellent. Now, still in your mind's eye, with your eyes closed, can you tell me, on this would be on your left, what has been posted? Which picture did I put up on the left of the sanctuary here on the wall for everyone to see? If you remember, just say out loud, tell me something about what I put up on the wall. Any distinguishing features there? Anyone at all? No one. Okay, you open your eyes and have a look. Well, that's because there's nothing there. There's nothing there. Can you imagine what it would be like having a blind person comment on the Mona Lisa? Tell you all they thought about that world-famous painting? Well, it's about as effective as it was for you being blind with your eyes closed, commenting on something that didn't exist. How can you comment on something you cannot see? Or how many of you are familiar with Beethoven's symphonies, Für Elise? You familiar with that song? Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Sound familiar? Everybody knows it. It's Für Elise. But if you were deaf, how would you comment and share with me the wonders of that symphony? How could you? It would be impossible for you. And so when the scripture says that the natural man does not receive the things of the spirit, this is no different. A natural man cannot understand the things of the spirit. To them, it's like, what? You guys are nuts. You Christians, beside yourselves. Makes no sense. Believe in this imaginary thing in your book of fairy tales. And I mean, this is the response you would expect from someone who is blind, from someone who is deaf, from someone who does not have the spirit. Because the things of the Spirit are spiritually discerned. And unless you have the gift of the Holy Spirit, which comes as a result of salvation, what hope have you got? It's not going to make sense to you. Now, we know that the unconverted, those who don't believe in God, we know that they can grasp enough of the gospel in their intellect to express faith, to bring them to the point where they can express faith and believe. We know that. But there are spiritual truths which just require more, that require the Holy Spirit to be given because they're spiritually discerned. And that's what we're referring to here. This is the hidden wisdom that the child of God possesses. But he that is spiritual judgeth all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. Those who are spiritual, and I would go as far as to say those who are spiritually mature, they judge all things. They are able to assess the things around them properly. They are able to use the function of discernment in such a way that God is honored and that protects them and blesses those around them. They judge all things. But they can look at them from a spiritual perspective. How many times in the church have you heard that we need to have our mindset on eternity? We need to have an eternal perspective. We need to think about the world that is yet to come. That is only possible if our focus isn't completely, fully established, our feet 100% planted here on earth. We need to have our minds out of this world and in another world, and that of the kingdom yet to come, so that we can discern the zeitgeist of our day, the spirit of the age, so that we might recognize where the world is at and how we are far removed from where the world is. This is spiritual reality at work in the life of a mature believer. and he himself is judged of no man. Well, Paul makes mention of this later, I think in chapter 4, and we'll be coming across that in the future. But Paul isn't too concerned about the judgment that comes from the world when they say, ah, you're crazy. You remember on Areopagus when Paul was there preaching this unknown God, when he got to the resurrection of Jesus Christ, or actually when he was sharing his testimony with Festus and who was the other fellow there, the King Agrippa. And Paul says, do you believe? Says to King Agrippa, do you believe? King Agrippa answers, almost persuadest thou me to be a Christian. But not before Festus said, Paul, thou art beside thyself. Much learning doth make thee mad. This is the world's response to the truth of the scriptures. The gospel was being preached, and Festus, a ruler, a nobleman in the world, thought, this guy's going nuts. He's crazy. He has no idea what he's talking about. Well, truly the one who was cuckoo was Festus, the one who missed out on the truth of the scriptures. I believe it was Festus Felix, one of those fellows. You read that account in the book of Acts. Paul was judged by Felix or Festus, but it didn't matter to him. God was going to be his judge. God, in fact, had already judged him and declared him innocent, justified, sanctified, and prepared for glory. That's the judgment that should be most concerning to the child of God, to the mature believer. So let the world say what they want to say. It's okay. Let them ridicule us. Let them make nothing of us. Let them call us whatever they want to call us. It's okay. We know who we are. Our security is not in what the world thinks of us. Our security and confidence lies in that hidden wisdom and the spiritual truth that we have received of God, that which he has revealed of himself. Remember, worlds apart. As high as the heavens are from the earth, so much higher than the ways and the wisdom of the world. For who hath known the mind of the Lord? Who has known the mind of the Lord, that he may instruct him? Is there anyone wise enough on the planet that has ever gone to God and sat him down and taught God a lesson like a school teacher? Never happened, but we have the mind of Christ. Wow. We have the mind of Christ. And do you know what that hidden mystery, that hidden wisdom, that secret of all the ages is? It is the truth of the gospel, which every believer has come to understand, because that's the only way they could have become a Christian. They have received the truth of the gospel. They have recognized and embraced that hidden truth, that mystery. Now, there is something special about this, and I want you to recognize how incredible it is that God has chosen to place us at such a time as this, that we have had the incredible liberty of being recipients of the gospel. It wasn't always readily available to everyone. The Apostle Peter says as much in 1 Peter 1, beginning at verse 10. Of which salvation, speaking of this salvation, this gospel, the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you. Can you imagine being one of the prophets, prophesying of this incredible Messiah who's going to come, of your hearts of stone being made new and soft, replaced with a heart that would be pliable and conformable into the image of the Lord? Think of preaching all of this, think of prophesying of it, but never experiencing it. That would have been tough. Talking about something you would never experience, telling others who didn't believe it that this was coming, something you didn't know about personally. But this grace has come to us. It continues in verse 11, searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ which was in them did signify, when it testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow.
unto whom it was revealed that not unto themselves, but unto us, they did minister the things sent down from heaven, minister the things which are now reported unto you by them that have preached the gospel unto you with the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven, which things the angels desire to look into. The angels themselves would have loved to grab an understanding of what this great mystery was, the mystery of the gospel, salvation for mankind. Wherefore, for this reason, because you have this information which they did not have, this secret hidden wisdom, this incredible mystery of God, wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind. Gird up the loins of your mind. Be sober and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. This is what that hidden secret wisdom should produce in us. Readiness, soberness, confidence. Believers are not ignorant. They are informed by the Word of God, which is made relevant to them by the Holy Spirit, which indwells them. In the eyes of the world, we may not be wise, but we wield the very hidden wisdom of God. We may not be seen as mighty, but if God be for us, who can be against us? The world doesn't see us as noble, but we are adopted heirs of the King of Glory. 1 Peter 2:9, but ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation, a peculiar people. Why? To what end? That ye should shew forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Amen. I'll close with this prayer. The world, or with this poem, the world has said while shaking head that Christians aren't too wise. They send the blind wisdom to find with their unopened eyes. The world looks down to cast a frown on those who are redeemed. Atop their perch, they mock the church as those lesser esteemed. A mystery of knowledge he has placed within our hand, the gospel of our Savior's love to save the souls of man. For as it stands across the lands, are Christians unashamed who make the choice to lift their voice, the word of God proclaim. The world is right that Christian might is not their strength or sword. The world was wrong while all along a Christian's might, the Lord. This chosen lot the Lord has sought to make his very own. These lowly few and humble too will gather round his throne. In Jesus Christ, we find our life. To him the glory be. The Lord of Lords in heaven adored through all eternity. Amen. Will you bow with me in closing prayer? Father, we come before you in full recognition that we haven't got what it takes. In our natural state, the greatest wisdom we could muster would fall short, would fall flat, would not accomplish for us what we need. But you, Lord, in your infinite wisdom, in your hidden wisdom, have revealed the mystery to all of those who have turned to you in faith. And that is that spiritual truth which can only be spiritually discerned, the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I pray, Lord, that being armed with the gospel of truth, we might proclaim that truth, that we might rejoice in the truth that you have revealed to us by your Spirit, and that we wouldn't fret when we're mocked by the world
Because the world doesn't grasp or understand these truths that they simply cannot grasp or understand. They are blind to what is right in front of their eyes. They are deaf to the proclamation of the gospel until they are spiritually awakened. Oh Lord, we pray that many more might come to the knowledge of the truth. We know that you are not willing that any should perish. I pray that we would be faithful with the word of God, that we would proclaim the truths, and that you by your Spirit would open the hearts, the minds of those who don't know you. We pray that those in Christ who are young and yet immature, we pray that they would move toward maturity, that they might walk in discernment, that they might have the depth to make a mark and make a difference in the world. Lord, this is our plea, our desire. We commit ourselves to you in the fulfilling of it. In Jesus' name, amen.